Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king. Behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had gathered all the chief priests and scribes of the people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. So they said to him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, 'But you, brethren, in the land of Judea are not the least among the rulers of Judea, for out of you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod, when he had secretly called the wise men, determined from them what time the star appeared, and he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the young child, and when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also." When they heard the king, they departed, and behold, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they had come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented gifts to him, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And being divinely warned in a dream they should not return to Herod, they departed for their own country another way. Now the day, well, I say the other day, it's been a while, but I heard read a story. It's a little humorous story. If the wise men had been women, they would have asked directions and arrived on time, helped deliver the baby, cleaned the stable, made a casserole, and brought practical gifts, including diapers, wipes, bibs, and formula. Well, that's an entirely different story. At any rate, Christmas to me seems to be just a celebration of something other than Christ. There are a lot of people who celebrate Christmas but want nothing to do with Christ. There are a lot of people who would never darken the door of a church but wouldn't hear of not celebrating Christmas. However, the truth of this matter is the wise still seek him. The unwise try to oppose him. The wise still worship him. There's a lot we don't know about the wise men. Some say they rode on camels. Most scholars seem to believe that they rode on horses. But we don't know. We don't know where they're from. A lot of biblical scholars say they're from Babylon. There's a lot we don't know about the wise men. But listen, if it were important, the Bible would have told us. We don't know. We do know that they were knowledgeable about scripture and prophecy and the stars, the star that led them to Jesus. We do know that they were exceedingly wise because the Bible said they sought out Jesus to worship him. The wisest thing you can do at Christmas or any other time is to worship Jesus Christ. A lot of people want the joys of Christmas without the joys of Jesus. Now, you may have a happy time, but you're never going to know the joys of Christmas unless you learn to worship Jesus Christ. The wisdom that these men had to seek out Christ and worship him. If these men were from Babylon, it's about 300 miles from Bethlehem in Judea. And I'm not saying that for sure, I'm just kind of using that for reference. But a 300-mile trip today, that even in a nice car, that can still wear you out. Can you imagine making a 300-mile trip in that kind of terrain? On foot, on a horse, on a camel, on a donkey. That's rough. There's a lot of people, man, if it's just sprinkling rain, they're not going to make it to church. There's a preacher and his wife laying in bed about 6 o'clock one morning. There's a huge clap of thunder, man. It rattled the windows of the house. The preacher's wife said, "Did you hear that?" He said, "What?" He said, "That's about 10,000 Baptists rolling over in the bed, going back to sleep." No, I'm just kidding, they were Methodists. I'm going to get in trouble. But these men came to worship Christ in spite of the difficulty. The wise seek him. Wise men from the east. Matthew starts out. He says, now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, the view that there was these three wise men comes from the gifts that were presented. How many wise men does the Bible say there were? It doesn't. We don't know. Men, I mean, there are at least two. More than likely. When they got to Jerusalem, they asked, "Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." What's this star that they saw? Many suggest it was just a natural phenomenon. I've heard it was a supernova, basically a star exploding. And there's a lot of other explanations, but Matthew made a point of showing the worship of these wise men, which stood in contrast to the Jews' religious leaders who knew the Holy Scriptures and did not need to travel very far to find their Messiah. The Jewish leaders directed the wise men to Bethlehem, but they didn't go themselves. Isn't that something? These wise men took a long journey, and they chose to worship Jesus, while the Jews chose to ignore him. Wisdom is the use of knowledge, the correct use of knowledge. To know is not to be wise. Many men know a great deal. They're all the greater fools for it. There's no fool so great as a fool as knowing God but not worshiping him. But to know how to use knowledge is to have wisdom. Romans 1:21 says, "Because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and in their foolish heart was darkened." There are many people today who think of themselves as wise, but their rejection of Christ showed that they're only fools. They reject the truth of God and believe a lie instead. 1 Corinthians 1:18 says, "For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved is the power of God." However, even worse are those who like the Jewish religious leaders, know the truth of the gospel and either reject or ignore it. Many people are going to miss out because they don't read, they don't believe, and they don't follow the scripture. They choose to celebrate Christmas, yet they want to take Christ out of it. They choose to celebrate Christmas, but the rest of the year they live like the devil. How can they ignore such great salvation? The truly wise are those who like the wise men of the account, they seek him, they serve him, they live for him. The wise still seek him. You can hear this message today and believe it in your mind and miss it altogether. Isn't it crazy? There's some unbelieving believers. Let that sink in. They never act on what they say they believe. The scriptures clearly tell of his first coming. The scriptures clearly tell of his second coming. There are some who missed his first coming, and there will certainly be a lot miss his second coming. They're not listening to the scriptures. When you set your heart to find God, he will do whatever it takes so that you may know him. I don't know what kind of star God will send you to bring you to him. It might be this sermon. It might be a neighbor. It might be a stranger. If you're looking for him, he'll make sure that you get there. If you don't want to know him, it's definitely not hard for him not to find you. Maybe he stopped calling. The Bible never says the star appeared to Herod. If you're serious about seeking God, I promise you, he will reveal himself to you. If you want to know him, you can know him. The wise men's news, it deeply disturbed Herod. He knew the Jewish people expected a Messiah to be coming pretty soon. Herod the Great was obviously disturbed for several reasons. Man, this guy was ruthless. And because of his many enemies, he was suspicious of someone to try to overthrow him. Herod didn't want the Jews, the religious people, to unite around the king. However, Matthew tells us that Herod wasn't the only one that was disturbed by this news. It was all of Jerusalem. Next, Matthew tells us when he gathered all the chief priests and scribes and people together, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. Herod needed some advice from the experts, so he called a meeting of the leading priests and scribes. So they told him, Bethlehem of Judah, for thus it is written by the prophet. The Jewish religious leaders understood that the Messiah would be born in Bethlehem. This fact is well known by the Jews. Ironically, when Jesus was born, the same religious leaders, these guys became his enemies. He asked the wise men when they first saw the star, then they told him, go and search carefully for the young child, and when you have found him, bring back word to me that I may come and worship him also. If he knew the exact time when they first saw the star, he would know the child's age. So the star had appeared 2 years earlier. Herod soon ordered the killing of all boys 2 years and older. Just like everyone in the past who has fought against Christ, they will lose. Herod, he tried and lost. Pilate, he tried and lost. Communists, and you look around today at the news, the people trying to kill Christ, trying to take him out of everything. They're going to lose. Matthew 16:18 says, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. They take away Christ out of Christmas. They take away the manger. They can take away the crosses, but they're never going to be able to take away the one for whom it stands for. They worship him. Worship means worthy of someone to be honored or worshipped. Had been told the child was born in Bethlehem, the wise men, they went their way. Once again, the star appeared to them as they traveled toward Bethlehem. Then the star stopped over the place where the child was. Matthew does not tell us what the star looked like, or how it moved, or how the wise men found the child from the movement and stopping of the star. Since the wise men have already been informed that the Messiah was to be born in Bethlehem, the star doesn't so much guide them to the town, but it shows them the place where he was. But Matthew made this point that God purposely sent this star to guide these men to his son. Matthew says that when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. That's pretty emphatic. Exceedingly great joy. Joy is an inner gladness, deep-seated pleasure. It's not just happiness. You can be happy and not be joyful? When was the last time you came to church like that, with exceedingly great joy? When they came to the house where Jesus and Mary and Joseph were, Matthew says they fell down and worshiped him. They fell down and worshiped him. Is that something you do to just a baby? It's a clear principle in Scripture that God alone is the only one to receive worship. Never someone in between. Me, Brother Robert, Pope, or whoever. We are not to worship anybody, anything, except God. In Revelation 19:10, an angel appeared to God. What did John do? He fell down and started to worship. And the angel's like, whoa. Get up. Don't do that. You'll get both of us in trouble. Don't do that. After they worshiped him, they presented him with gifts. But they didn't bring a bunch of junk either. First thing they brought him was gold. Just think about that. What they make out of gold? They make jewels, crowns for kings. It's a pretty nice gift. They brought frankincense. Frankincense was used in the Holy of Holies, and used as an ingredient for perfumes, but. It was for ceremonial reasons. It's only permitted in on the altar. In Exodus chapter 30, it says it was not to be used for any other purpose. It's sacredly used for him and myrrh. This was a spice used in perfume, and it was used for embalming. It was a gift for a person who's going to die. Do we bring our best when we come to worship? The wise men worshiped him. Angels worshiped him. The shepherds worshiped him. What do we do? We're worried about, we might not sing our favorite Christmas song. We're concerned how to pay the Visa card after the holidays because of all the presents and stuff we bought. We're thinking about that ugly tie that Aunt Martha gave us. I don't know if those jeans we got for Christmas are going to make our bottom end look big. We want to know if the Christmas carols we're singing are right. When we sing those Christmas carols, are we singing, we're just singing, or we're just worshiping? When we sing, "Oh Come Let Us Adore Him," are we? Let's make Christmas about worship. The wisdom of Christmas is that we still seek him. The unwise, they're still going to oppose him. But the wise are going to worship him. What about you? Are you wise? Do you seek Jesus every day with all your heart? Do you truly worship Jesus with all your heart? Do you show by your actions that you oppose Jesus? Will you be counted among the wise at Christmas? Do you want to be wise this Christmas? You need to seek Jesus in the way that they saw him. And these guys went without abandon. They recognized the star. They knew what they were going to do. They were going to seek that child out and worship him because he was God. He was Jesus Christ. He was the Messiah. Recognize who he is and know that all that you have, your worship, your life, is all his. And I'm going to ask Brother Robert to come down and stand here, Brother James, and Miss Christy, and Miss Pat. We're going to have a time of invitation. Listen, be wise this Christmas and seek him like the wise men did.